This video is sponsored by Surfshark. What is the very first Thai dish you can think of? I asked this question on Instagram and the answer was overwhelmingly Pad Thai. Obviously. I know Thai cuisine has so much to offer, but at least in terms of international recognition, it's gonna be very difficult to beat Pad Thai. And until very recently, I was sure it's gotta be this old traditional Thai dish. Well, let's just say I could not have been more wrong. What if I told you that not too long ago, there was this Thai dictator who wanted a strong Thai nation and that Pad Thai, that dish we all love, was designed from scratch as a central part of his plan? Oh, and that to this day, the Thai government is spending millions and millions of dollars just to control what you, me, and the rest of the world thinks about Thai food? Okay, I know this is a lot, but please let me explain.
In a remote corner of our earth stands the little kingdom of Siam, one of the last of the world's absolute monarchies, where 10 million people live their lives in partial seclusion from the outside world.
Let's start the story around 100 years ago, in a time before Pad Thai and, in fact, before Thailand. Back then, the country was called Siam and was a kingdom in a precarious situation. It was sandwiched between Burma, a colony of the British Empire, and French Indochina, a colony of, well, France. In a time where colonialism was still at its peak, Siam was part of a very exclusive club of Asian countries that have not been formally colonized, and there were only two other members. One of them was China. For the longest time, it resisted Western-style modernization and, as a result, endured a so-called century of humiliation, in which colonizers from Europe, but also internal weaknesses, had left what used to be an epic empire in shatters. The other one was Japan. It adopted a constitution, lots of Western-style modernization, and managed to really get its economy going and even defeat Russia, a European empire, in a war. And to the scholars and, of course, the royal family of Thailand, that second option sounded a whole lot better. Whether they liked it or not, they saw the formation of a modern Siamese state around the crown as the only way of protecting it from aggressive colonial powers. Since the mid-19th century, the kings of Siam were receiving full Western educations in addition to studying their own cultural heritage. Actually, if you've seen the movie Anna and the King, that's kind of about that. But if you think the kings of Siam had an ambitious vision for the country, well, wait until you meet this guy. Enter Plek Pibun Songkram. We'll just call him Pibun for this video. A military man grown up in Siam, but having studied in Europe, he was not just interested in a modern state for his country. No, he was straight up inspired by a rising group of fascist European leaders, Mussolini in Italy and Hitler in Germany. That is the kind of nation Pibun had in mind for Siam. So in 1932, he becomes part of the Siamese Revolution, a military coup that basically reduced the royal family to a symbolic institution, and after internal power struggles, Pibun emerged as a de facto dictator of Thailand in 1938. And oh boy, did he take his new job seriously. First order of business, a fresh new brand. Siam was now officially called Thailand, which has been an informal name until then, and it had this nice patriotic ring to it. And this new Thailand, it was everywhere. There was a new anthem, a militaristic everyday culture, the face of Pibun was everywhere, and his famous words got repeated in newspapers and media all day long. Okay, but that's the classic Führer playbook, am I right? Every self-respecting dictator did that, so what was special about Pibun? Well, let's just say it was his hands-on approach to creating a new Thai culture. He believed that Thailand had the right stuff to not just survive, but actually thrive and become the dominant power in Southeast Asia. Only that, you know, the people could use a little bit of work, according to him. Stronger, more disciplined, more civilized. But maybe most importantly, this big, super diverse country of former Siam needed a new common Thai identity. Pibun comes up with a total of 12 cultural mandates, which led to tons of totalitarian rules on how a proper Thai person should live their lives, starting with consuming only Thai products down to how people dress, which language they speak, how they say hello in that language, and even at what hours they sleep. If you ask me, in spite of very strong competition, that kind of puts him in the Champions League of 20th century dictators. And now what do you think? Would a dictator like that really pass up on the chance of telling people what food they should eat? Of course not. One of Pibun's top priorities, the new Thailand, needed a new national dish. So for hundreds, if not thousands of years, the everyday staple food in Thailand was rice, eaten with some form of seasoned chili paste, which kind of sounds like a proto-curry to me. But it must have been pretty good, because back in the 17th century, a French diplomat reported that after 3 months of eating surprisingly nourishing rice dishes in Siam, his ship's crew was devastated to have to go back to biscuits for the journey back. I don't know, that's neither here nor there, but I just really like this fun fact. There was a problem though. Every so often, Thailand would get hit by floods, and whenever that happened, rice supply was critically low for the rest of the year. That was a no-go for Pibun. For his strong and healthy Thai nation, he needed more food security than that, and there was one easy solution. Noodles. And specifically this type of rice noodle that we all know today. I mean, yes, they're also made from rice, but actually it's old rice, which is already an advantage. And also they allow you to extend the shelf life of a rice harvest by, you know, up to a few years. And also it's just a very efficient production process, allowing you to get, you know, more bang for your buck. So Pibun starts this huge national noodle project, promoting the hell out of these noodles. He's holding entire speeches about them. Songs about noodles are written and performed all over the country. Full steam noodle propaganda. And what's important to know is that to most people, noodles were actually an innovation. With a few small exceptions, they just weren't a thing in Thailand back then. I mean, they did exist, but they were usually considered Chinese food. You could buy them from a Chinese merchant or a Chinese street hawker, which was actually an increasingly popular blue-collar lunch. I mean, the Thai word for noodles is actually a loanword from the Chinese Chaozhou dialect. But this association with Chinese food was actually a big problem for Pibun. In his Thai-first ideology, there was no room for the many ethnic minorities in the country, which he actively oppressed, as you can guess. Almost overnight, Chinese noodle hawkers basically disappeared off the streets. And in good old dictatorial fashion, a new standardized noodle is developed, apparently distinctly Thai. Even though, for the life of me, I could not find out what made it special. But at the center of this entire noodle campaign was a new dish, designed completely from scratch, Pad Thai. Translation, the Thai stir fry. Of course, it was built around the new noodles, but it also featured a number of very common Thai ingredients, each one carefully selected to not just boost people's protein intake, but also support products and industries from all parts of Thailand. Or at least that's the official lore, because, you know, many decades later, Pibun's son actually gave an interview in which he said that this just happened to be a dish that the family was served during the 30s by their private chefs, so yeah. Either way, Pibun was very serious about Pad Thai. His government mandated state-run canteens and schools to serve Pad Thai, they handed out recipe cards to the people, subsidized Pad Thai street food hawking, even on boats if needed, ensured an affordable supply of ingredients, and just put noodles and Pad Thai on the menus and into the mouths of Thai people. And as we all know today, it worked. Pretty damn well, actually. I can't speak for Thai people, but at least in my part of the world, Pad Thai is definitely seen as one of the national dishes of Thailand. But speaking of which, what I know about Pad Thai, along with many other Europeans and millions of people around the world, is not actually a coincidence. If you think the story of Pad Thai ends here, oh no, we're just getting started, because everyone's favorite government-sanctioned Thai dish is gonna go global, and that's where we get to the conspiracy part of this video. Right after a message from this video's sponsor, Surfshark. Surfshark is a VPN service, which means it keeps you and your data safe by encrypting everything you send through the internet. That alone is a great reason to use Surfshark. I make sure to always have it on when I'm entering personal info, or I just don't want creepy ads to follow me around the internet. But you wanna know another great reason to use Surfshark? I recently wanted to watch this movie Stowaway. I'm a big sucker for space movies. And it is actually on Netflix, only not where I live. But is that really gonna be a problem? Well, not with Surfshark, it's not. All I had to do is select one of their US-based servers, which, you know, they have them all around the world, and then refresh, boom. There it is, Stowaway, available for me to stream in glorious HD. A VPN is such a great tool to have on hand, but don't take my word for it, try it. Right now, Surfshark has a great deal going on. If you use my link in the video description and promo code Andong, you will receive 83% off. You also get 3 whole months for free, and as if that's not enough, there's a 30-day money-back guarantee. So if you try it and you don't like it, simply cancel your subscription, you'll get your money back, and it might just be enough to get yourself a bowl of Pad Thai. Thank you, Surfshark, for sponsoring this video, and now back to Pad Thai. So Pibun's whole noodle campaign was happening around World War II, which was, you know, a turbulent time, and he eventually started losing power and died in exile in the 60s. And over the decades, Thailand went through a lot. The country was developing rapidly, governments and kings came and went, but the crazy few years of Phibun's hyper-nationalist rule left a legacy. The country was, and still is, called Thailand, and the new national dish of Pad Thai turned out to be a self-fulfilling prophecy. You now had a whole generation of people all across the country united by, you know, having grown up with Pad Thai and loving it. And they carried that new tradition forward all by themselves. Within Thailand, that is. Because except for a few hotspots around the world that had local Thai populations, like Southern California or Sydney, Australia, for example, Thai food around the world was almost non-existent. But within those hotspots, Thai food was starting to become the hot new thing, and I'm not surprised because it's damn delicious. But here's the kicker. A few very smart people inside the Thai Ministry of Commerce's Department of Export Promotion, they kind of got wind of this emerging Thai food craze around the world, and they saw a massive opportunity. In a project modestly referred to as Global Thai, they start pumping millions and millions into the international promotion of Thai food. They started training chefs, giving out loans, strengthening export infrastructure, funding marketing campaigns. They even created cookie cutter templates for three different types of Thai restaurants, like a fast food chain, a more formal one, and a super fancy one. Basically, anyone in Thailand who was willing to open and run a Thai restaurant abroad had everything laid out for them. And it really didn't take long, maybe a decade or so, until there was a global network of Thai restaurant associations and organizations, and diplomats started using embassy contacts to make deals and ensure a steady flow of supplies, starting from, you know, ingredients all the way down to restaurant furniture. I mean, they even talked New Zealand into creating a whole new category of visa specifically for Thai chefs. And even though those cookie-cutter restaurants never really took off, the campaign overall was still a huge phenomenal success. As the number of Thai restaurants in developed countries around the world skyrockets and exports soar, the number of tourists now curious to explore Thailand's culture, beaches, and of course food grows with them. Overall, Thai food became a huge soft power win for the country, massively increasing its popularity and clout internationally. I mean, for countless people around the world, including this guy, I first heard about Thailand through the food, and I had a very good first impression. And while this strategy doesn't sound crazy by today's standards, back in the 2000s, Thailand was considered a pioneer in the newly emerging field of gastro-diplomacy. Their strategy was studied meticulously, and since then, a whole number of other countries have launched similar campaigns. To me, maybe the most curious thing about this campaign, though, is that it's a move straight out of old Phibun's playbook. Once again, by top-down decree, food is being standardized and aggressively promoted to broadcast a constructed idea of what Thai culture is. I mean, fortunately today, the people behind the campaign aren't part of a totalitarian regime anymore, but the Thai government's fingerprints are still all over this. Just check this out. There's a project called Thai Select. Aside from being very active in promoting Thai food around the world, there is certification awarded by the Ministry of Commerce, the Royal Thai Government, to guarantee the authentic Thai taste of Thai food products and Thai restaurants in Thailand and overseas. Actually, if you happen to run a Thai restaurant or you're a Thai chef, please comment below and let me know what your experience with all of that has been. But yeah, if you check the Thai Select website, there are of course very specific instructions on how to cook all of that Thai food, including of course a recipe for Pad Thai, which officially brings us full circle. On the other hand, that standardization is also the reason why a lot of Thai restaurant menus around the world are actually almost the same. And they're not just the same. They're being called authentic, but of course that is the Thai government's version of authentic. How much do they actually represent the super diverse cultures and cuisines of Thailand? I don't know, but I have a hunch that it's not very much. And look, I'm not here to hate. Of course, today Pad Thai is a very real Thai dish, loved by many, many people inside and outside of Thailand. And you know what? For what it's worth, the government recipe actually looks pretty solid. I just want all of us to think twice when we talk about authentic food, because the history of Pad Thai is one that I sort of managed to piece together in this video, but just imagine how many of these stories are out there and we're not even aware of them. On the other hand, that's what you have me for, because I have found a lot of joy in exploring these stories. So if you have a hot lead for me, an exciting food story, please make sure to reach out over Instagram or something. And otherwise, thank you for watching, and I'm gonna see you in the next video.